Well, thank you very much for coming in. It's such a great turnout. The last 4 or 5 weeks have been terrible weeks from my perspective for Barack Obama, from his perspective, and two. First, there was the AP case, and that is the case in which the government subpoenaed secretly through the phone companies, AP's records with respect to a leaked story about a terrorist operation in Yemen. That caused a tremendous controversy because the subpoena was much too large. And then Fox News got into it because its reporter, James Rosen, was listed as a co-conspirator with respect to someone who had leaked Rosen, who was Kim, a gentleman named Kim, who had leaked Rosen a story about North Korea's nuclear intentions. That was a major controversy because the reporter was named as a co-conspirator. I'll come back to these, but I just wanted to start off where all the fighting has been. And then, of course, last couple of weeks, we had the NSA leak and the controversy that came about with respect to the NSA. That catapulted little me, who wrote a history of something that happened 40 years ago, right on the top of the wave into the middle of the controversy, because my book is about leaks. It's about Pentagon Papers and then subsequent battles, and it ends up predicting, and this was published 2 months ago, that Obama in effect would do the things he ended up doing after my book came out. So everyone wanted to know, how did you know that? And you know, I had to be on this and that. And so if you can believe it, as of last week, in a period of 3 weeks, I did 56 interviews. Now, which would be wonderful for an author, and it was. But I have to tell you, I'm probably bigger in Denmark and in Russia, in Canada, in Spain, et cetera, than I am in the United States. As a matter of fact, it's sort of interesting because, as I will tell you, the end thrust of my book is about Julian Assange. And when you say Julian Assange to the established media, they turn off, and they won't cover you. Not that I ever expected to be covered to begin with, but compared to the coverage I'm getting on the internet, which is absolutely huge, it's really surprising how uninterested the regular media is. Now, you all remember about the Pentagon Papers. My book is based on the premise, why you know about it, you really don't know anything about it, because the case was tried in secret, and it's a secret case. And what my book does is open up the secrets of what the Pentagon Papers case. I'm not the first person to do that, really, but I'm probably the first person to put it all together. And so the purpose of the book is to open up the secrets, look at the history, try to learn the lesson from the history of the Pentagon Papers case, and then, as I say in my book, apply it to Obama. Now, you remember the Pentagon Papers case was a case that was based on a leak from Daniel Ellsberg, who was an employee of the Rand Corporation, to the New York Times, of a 47-volume history of Vietnam called the Vietnam Archives. And the Times published parts of the study. It was enjoined. Thereafter, the Washington Post published parts of it. It was enjoined. And then the two cases went up together to the Supreme Court. And surprisingly enough, and that's why I'm here, the New York Times and the Washington Post were victorious. Now, when you go back and pull out what was going on in this case, you really are quite shocked. Because the claims of national security then were pretty much the same as the claims of national security are made today. In other words, when somebody says we can't have an NSA leak because the terrorists will know and we'll all get blown up, which there may be some truth in that, as a matter of fact, I want to tell you that the quality of the claims for national security in the Pentagon Papers case were the same. And I think that all of us who were in the case were impressed with the claims, because if you think about national security claims, they're prospective. In other words, if you publish something or if you let the NSA secrets out, it will damage national security in the future. So the government said, if you publish any of the Pentagon Papers case, it will damage national security, future. What my book does is say, hey, let's go back and take a look at what actually was claimed and whether it proved out. Well, I don't want to give away the whole secret of my secret book, but let's face it, there wasn't much there. And therefore, you come to the conclusion when it comes to claims of national security, excuse me, Maurice, don't believe them. Don't believe what the government says, or at least make them make a case for the claim. And when you start getting into cases for claims for national security, and you start getting in the middle of them, it's surprising, excuse me, Reese, how flimsy the cases are. And therefore, I think that the lesson for Obama is don't believe him. When they make those claims of national security, make them prove it and push back. Now, it seems to me that being the lesson of the Pentagon Papers, roughly characterized, when you ask how Obama has dealt with the same phenomenon, in my humble opinion, he's done very, very badly. Because he started off, didn't start off, but really his first phase of his career as president with respect to the national security and the press, was he indicted six leakers. That's more than any other president in the history of the United States, because the amount of leakers indicted previously amounted to three, and he did six. He has chased James Risen. Do we know who James Risen is? James Risen is the New York Times reporter who broke the first NSA story. There are two parts of the NSA story. One is PRISM, we've heard of PRISM, and the other is metadata on phones. We can talk about it in the Q&A if you'd like. He broke the story about PRISM. And he was the one who was told if he published that story, if the Times did, there would be blood on the hands of the New York Times. And guess what? It's the very same story that was leaked first to Glenn Greenwald. And so he's not been a friend of any presidency. Now, under the Obama administration, Obama has chased him around and effectively wants to put him into jail for publishing a leak about Iran's nuclear program. He won the first bout with the government with respect to the disclosure of sources as to the Iranian leak. And the case is up on appeal. And it's been sitting there for 14 to 15 months. When that case comes down, there's a high probability we're going to have another big controversy with Obama trying to put Risen in jail. And the list goes on and on and on. The one issue that bothers me the most is what Obama's Justice Department wants to do with Julian Assange. And that's the penultimate point of my book. I take the history and then apply it, and I end up with Assange. Why Assange? I was on the, by the way, guess what? I was on the phone with Julian Assange today. Daniel Ellsberg and a gentleman whose name is Drake. Drake is a former NSA employee who was one of the six people who was indicted by Obama, but he turned the case around and won it, and provided a great embarrassment to Obama and me, the four of us. But guess what? Well, I had NBC News, CBS, you name it. But they didn't seem to want to talk to me. They all wanted to talk to Julian Assange. And what Julian Assange said today is really what I say in my book. He called upon President Obama to stop the prosecution of WikiLeaks. And he said that the prosecution that's in place for Julian Assange is one of the greatest prosecutions of its kind ever in the history of the United States, which surprised me because it may surprise you too, since most people I talk to don't even know that he's being prosecuted. And when I wrote the chapter in my book about his prosecution, I had to dig here and dig there and sort of guess, and I got way out on the limb, and it looks like I'm going to be right. So his argument, it turns out, is the same argument that I have in my book. I've never talked to him, and I would say privately he's not my favorite person, Julian Assange. But when you start thinking about what Julian Assange did, you begin to get worried, and this is why. What Julian Assange did was he published the leaks that were leaked to him by Private First Class Bradley Manning, who is in the Army and who leaked huge volumes of data about Afghanistan, about Iraq, and tons of cables. That information was leaked to Julian Assange. Now, who is Assange? Assange had a website called WikiLeaks. As we know, or maybe don't, he's an Australian, and he's part of this worldwide group of people who thinks that all information should be absolutely free. I don't happen to share that conviction, but that's where he's coming from. And he had a system whereby Manning could deliver information to Assange, and his anonymity and anyone else's would be assured because of the technological system that he had set up. Now, Assange took this material and he gave it to a series of newspapers, including the New York Times, the El Pais, Figaro, and other papers. Those other papers took the material that had been given to them, they edited it, and they decided to publish it. And they gave it back to Assange. And they all published their edited versions of the WikiLeaks material that had been leaked to WikiLeaks. And then Assange published the same material. And later on, someone got a hold of his password, and a lot more was published than was published in the New York Times. And Assange sort of let out all of the WikiLeaks. And that's why we have the Bradley Manning case going on today, which is a case and a trial of a leaker. And that's why Julian Assange was holding his press conference today and why I wrote my last chapter, because he and I, but particularly me from a publishing point of view, are very concerned if the government prosecutes Julian Assange. Now, why do you say? Pentagon Papers case was a censorship case. The government came in, it tried to stop the New York Times from publishing, it lost the case. We don't talk about those kind of cases much anymore because the internet is here and everything happens so fast. So what is going on now as sort of a substitute, you might say, for injunctions against the press are threatened criminal prosecutions of publishers and reporters. And that has never happened in the history of this country before. So I wrote this chapter saying, please, Mr. President, do not try to go after Julian Assange for publishing what he did and acting as a journalist and getting the material, because if you succeed, you're going to make every journalist who asks for information from those who have access to classified information into a criminal. Now, when I wrote this, I said it was 2 months ago, it seemed like a shot in the dark. Most people probably didn't care much about it. Maybe they don't today. Julian Assange won't be prosecuted. Where is he, by the way? He's in the Ecuadorian embassy. Why is he there? Because his lawyers think that as soon as he steps out of the embassy and then goes to Sweden, you may remember he's wanted in Sweden for sexual malpractice. You know, we have all sorts of malpractice these days. Now we have sexual malpractice. And then people think he's going to come back and going to face the grand jury that is conducting the largest investigation ever, according of a sort according to Assange. Well, you might say, so what? Well, here's why I got caught up in all of this. First, we had the AP leak, which was, you know, just part of my fodder for me, because the information that was sought was so broad and it was so secret that the whole process struck people the wrong way. I mean, why didn't the government, if they want information from the AP, first ask AP for it? If they want it from a number of reporters, cut down the amount. It was overbroad. So that was the first thing that happened. Then Fox News gets in the picture with Rosen. Now, what they did with Rosen was they said, Rosen, when you asked for that leaked information about North Korea, you acted criminally because you are a co-conspirator. And that charge was made with respect to a search warrant of the leaker's information. Well, Fox News went bananas over that. And in fact, I went bananas over it and called for Holder's resignation. Because in my way I'm looking at things, if we end up with reporters as criminals, we're not going to learn any of the information that the government has. And all the information the government has really is classified, you know, because that's the way the system works. So that would mean the government would have total control of that information. And if someone tried to get it, they would run the risk of being tried as a criminal. Had this ever happened before? Well, one of the interesting things I found out in my book when I went back and researched it was that Nixon tried to do the same thing to Neil Sheehan, the New York Times reporter, and tried to go after him as a conspirator. And that's what Rosen was called. And that's what I say in my book will be the characterization given to Assange, that if he is sought for criminal behavior, it won't be because he is a leaker or because he violated the Espionage Act or that he violated any act at all, except he conspired with Manning, who violated the act. So he can be convicted under an act effectively that doesn't apply to him. And so when Fox saw that possibility, they went wild. And I became a Fox News contributor. I was Fox News favorite reporter, because I said that if Obama succeeds in his prosecution against Assange for being a criminal, when Assange published the same material as the New York Times, and therefore he would be a publisher, no question about that. He tried to get the material into his website. Most people think he's a journalist. You can argue about that, but he's clearly a publisher. If you can get Assange for publishing classified information, then you can get everybody else who publishes classified information. And that would not be good for us, I would submit. So my penultimate chapter is, will Obama succeed where Nixon failed? Because Nixon failed in his attempt to do the same thing 40 years ago. And then it became, well, if you say that, do you think that Obama is worse than Nixon? And so I would say, I think he's a half game out of first place. He's moving fast. He's going to pass Nixon. This is before the FISA stuff, by the way. If, in fact, he goes forward with this prosecution. So the bottom line is that my book is a book about leaks. It's about the greatest leak that ever happened in this country. And it takes it up to date with respect to the leak, which is second in size, that would be WikiLeaks, and compares the two. This is a warning to Obama. And in between, we've had all these things that are related to events in my book, because I cover most leaks, that's to say AP and Rosen. And so, as they say in New York, the whole McGill has been a lot of fun. Thank you. Yes?
You said you don't agree with those that say that all information should be public. But then we have this odd situation today in that people like Assange who set up a business for the purpose of enticing and revealing secret information. Manning, who clearly broke the law by delivering it up. Ellsberg, who did the same thing, lots of others. Whenever anybody actually gives away the information or reveals the information, everybody says, oh, no, we shouldn't touch them. So the question I would have is, if we really think that there is some information that should not be revealed.
Yeah. Well, I think that,
excuse me. Who could ever be worthy of prosecution, and if so, under what circumstances? Because if we can't do Assange or Manning or Ellsberg or any of the other six right. or whatever, is there anybody who can be prosecuted?
Well, I think the way I analyze it, as I say, first of all, we've got a general proposition. Should all information be free? And so we take the simple case, first of all, and that's to say the information that we all have or we all create. My great book is not out there for anyone to steal. The secrets that the Google Corporation has are theirs. So we, on the private side, there are indications of information that can be kept proprietary. And then with respect to answering directly your question, I think the answer is this, this is the way I do it. I say, if the information that is released constitutes a clear and present danger to the security of the United States, then it can be penalized. But if it can't, it shouldn't be subject to draconian penalties. The punishment should fit the crime. Now, this question came up early. Can I just finish this thing? Yeah, but this question came up early in the Pentagon, in this history I've talked about, which, by the way, is a David against Goliath sort of history, where I'm David with my slingshot because no one will listen to me, and the lawyers quit, and I'm left out in the cold, and the issue becomes, well, where do you draw the line when you talk about people who are going to represent you, what sort of position you're going to take in court? And the being a Second World War person, not many left, it always seemed to me, for example, that in wartime to publish the secret of the atomic bomb is subject to all sorts of penalties. And I think you can make other military analogies. In other words, I don't believe that all information should be free, because I don't think the First Amendment should be totally absolute. There should be exceptions to it, but I think they should be narrow, and they should be subject to some sort of analysis along the lines I've just indicated.
Can I just one thing?
Yeah.
With other things, like for instance theft.
Like
theft,
what?
Things, other crimes, things like theft. Theft is wrong no matter how valuable the thing you steal. Okay. What you seem to be saying that breaking the secrecy laws is actually only sometimes something that should be illegal.
No, that's not what I'm glad you asked me that question. First place, there are no secrecy laws in this country. We all talk about the Espionage Act, but the espionage, which is applied to secrets, I could see that. But the espionage, when I started, had never been applied to it. I was the first person to look at the Espionage Act a million years ago. But the Espionage Act is for giving information to the enemy, not to the press. But anyway, it's been used. And then your question is, would you agree that under the circumstances you described, does a person get off? I don't think so. My position, which is a little different than my introducer, is that people who work for institutions, Google or anything else, if they are going to leak, unless they're pure whistleblowers, whatever that means, should be subject to penalty. They should be fired from corporations. Bradley Manning, the case is going on now. He has pled to 20 years in prison. I think that's what he should get. I don't understand why the government wants to put him away for more than 20 years. So I think if you're going to be a civil disobedient, you take on the risk of the penalty that's going to be applied to you. You decide you're going to go away. But it's worth it to get the information off. But you don't You don't get off all the way, and I don't think you need draconian penalties if, in fact, the facts support somewhat what you've done.
Just before I got here, and I just showed it to him, I received an email from Dan Ellsberg, who I happen to know, on behalf of, but from the ACLU. It was sent out to the whole ACLU, which I will forward to Patricia so you can send it out to everybody, because it's an open email. And basically, the subject line says bigger than the Pentagon Papers. And I'm not going to go through the whole thing that's here, but it's Dan, and I also happen to know Neil and Susan Sheehan really well, and the story of how they, I'm glad that you mentioned about persecuting Neil Sheehan, not just the New York Times, because they went after Neil, I mean, 40 years ago, they were going after reporters just like they're doing right now.
That's right.
But basically, this is on behalf of the ACLU. Well, I just didn't know if you knew about Dan's involvement in the current cases.
Oh, do I ever?
And now the ACLU getting involved with it also.
Okay, so Dan, I'm on the phone with Dan today, as I said. And we had a few minutes before the press conference started, and so we started talking about the NSA leak. Now, I briefly sketched out the NSA leak. It's metadata about phones, and it's email, phone email, and regular email for PRISM. With respect to the metadata point, does everyone know what I mean by metadata? In other words, what the government is doing, the breadth of this is a little surprising. What the government is doing is every single phone call that's made in the United States has a little code next to it in a government database, which shows the number of the calling number and the receiving number at the very least. And what the Congress has been saying, well, that's so little, why worry about? But Dan's theory on it, and I think he may be right, but I'm not sure, is that not only is the metadata there, but the phone call itself is stored. And while the phone call is not accessible, unless you go back and get a search warrant, it is there, and it works backwards. It's all the phone calls. In other words, when you normally get a search warrant, it looks forward, right? You're looking at you get a wiretap on someone who's going to make calls. Dan's theory is, and he's got a complicated algorithm almost, you might say, that if you work out a million square feet in Utah, Idaho, wherever the hell it is, that the NSA is storing all this stuff. It doesn't make any sense unless they're storing phone calls too, because it's too much space for too little information. So Dan is saying if that is so, I mean, that really is pretty horrendous, because even though the phone calls aren't accessible, to have everyone's phone calls in the United States is pretty extraordinary. I have a problem with the other program, but I won't get into that. I would just say, here's the theme that runs through Obama and in my last chapters. He's overdoing everything in the interest of national security. He's got six, it'll be seven, leakers. Well, he should use some discretion. Now, no one says he shouldn't go after, let all leakers go, but seven is just too many. With respect to the NSA, he should have pushed back. He took this program from Bush, the best I can determine, adopted it, and didn't push back on it. Now he's defending it. For example, in the so-called phone part of the program, in yesterday's hearing, a congressman asked the person who's testifying on behalf of the NSA, well, why don't you just take the same phone information and put it back into the phone companies where it always was? And, you know, you can issue a subpoena. Do you see the difference? And the answer was, well, we can get it quicker if it's sitting out there. Well, I mean, that's not a good answer. And they pushed me a little further, and the person testifying on behalf of the NSA said, well, you know, that's not a bad idea, we'll consider it. But my God, you know, 6 years later, where was Obama should have been pushing back rather than just an accepting the claim of national security, which is where I started my talk. Yeah.
On a different standpoint, I'm just curious what your opinion is. If you have if someone publishes information that's factually correct, and then the person who it's published about claims it ruined their career, do you think that should be permissible?
Well, then you're asking, is truthful information always entitled to a free ride?
Right.
Isn't that basically? I would think my position is probably yes.
And why would that be?
Well, I think the truth, once you start saying that some material can't be published because it hurts people's feelings or violates their privacy, you're basically setting up a private censorship system that's very hard to run. How do you determine once you say that truthful information can be punished? Not everyone agrees with me on that, but that's where I come from. No.
Where is the initiative for these prosecutions coming from? Is it from Holder, the NSA, or the executive office?
Yeah, that's a sort of a fun question, because how is it that all of a sudden we've got seven prosecutions, or six now, and a seventh hanging out there? Before, we only had three in the history of the United States. Where do we get the energy, the impetus for someone to put out a broad-ranging subpoena for Associated Press information without telling AP till after it's done? And more importantly, what's going on with this grand jury that's been secret so long with respect to Assange? Well, all of a sudden, according to Assange, is huge and running all over the place. Well, there are various ways of looking at life in Washington. I don't come from Washington, but I would suggest it starts at the top. And I'm not going to say that Obama is responsible for every little thing himself and he's micromanaging it. But when you have a president who says, as I point out in my book, I think that everyone who leaks commits espionage. And that just can't be true. Stop to think about it. If somebody gives a story to a reporter and it's published, that's not espionage. As I said earlier, it's got to be given to the enemy. If he starts with that premise, it sends a message. Now, where does the message go? It goes to Holder. Holder is responsible for running the Justice Department. And I don't think he's very tough guy to run the Justice Department. And it's not an easy department to run. So I think you have a second weak link in the chain. But the energy, to answer your question, the best I can determine comes from a unit within the Justice Department, which is an anti-leak unit. And they consist of career Justice Department lawyers and apparently one particular gentleman who is rabid on the subject. So it may be in real life, while I sit here and blame Obama for it, and I think I should, because if you're at the top, you're responsible. The energy is probably from career Justice Department lawyers who know their ropes even better than Holder does, and they drag him around.
Yeah. I'd like to ask how two other recent leaks, NSA leaks, fit into this paradigm. One of them is Vickers giving information to Catherine Bigelow to make Zero Dark 30. And the other is Petraeus giving information to his mistress. And I wonder if you think those two...
I don't know. You're going to have to tell us what that's all about, because I don't know what that's all about.
Well, the big Hollywood film last year, Zero Dark 30, about the hunt for Osama bin Laden.
Oh, yeah.
Information to make that film from within the CIA.
Oh, yeah.
Is that...
Did she get... Oh, yeah.
She did.
Well, that was sort of funny. You're saying she generally got the information, but... The former defense secretary was addressing a whole group of gentlemen who'd been in that super unit and calling them out by name, not knowing that the PR people had put the producer inside the room and that he was effectively leaking to her. Well, what's the question? The question is, what do I think of it? Good for her.
Within the same paradigm as publishing. publishes.
Yeah, same, yeah. Yeah, broadcast, movies, it's all the same idea, broadcasting. Yeah.
Given that one Dan Starr-like person in the Justice Department can do all this damage to our rights, then what's the avenue to blow the thing up? What's the Pentagon Papers now that could be used? Is it a Supreme Court case? What do you do to try and make something happen?
Can't change things around?
Yeah.
Well, you know, I have to say that in dealing with that question, the only answer I could think was to get everybody to yell. Because I don't see a quick legal outcome to all of this. Now, in the Pentagon Papers case, what's fun about it is that it's a drama. You don't know what's going to happen from day to day. The government's coming this way, it's going that way. It's making up claims. The Solicitor General of the United States, the former Dean of Harvard Law School,
Irwin Griswold,
he took a piece of paper that said the newspapers had broken the North Vietnamese code and gave it secretly to the Supreme Court. And he knew that was a lie. There's all that sort of stuff going around, but in a framework of, 13, 14 days, so you knew quickly what the answer was. But here, we've got all this stuff going on. We're going to have litigation about the NSA program. We're going to have litigation about some of those cases that I described. And I don't see that giving us an answer in terms of dealing with Obama, because he'll be gone by the time that's through. So, you know, what can I do? I raise my tiny voices a little larger because of what happened the last two or three weeks. But I'm going around and trying to get people excited about all this, and I don't know if I'm succeeding or not. Yeah.
Do you think Scooter Libby should be pardoned and not have been prosecuted for his leak?
No, I don't think Scooter Libby should have been. He wasn't pardoned, right?
He was
commuted. No, I wouldn't have cleared Scooter Libby's name. I mean, he did a lot of things wrong, not the least of which was he took a national, he was cleared to do this, but the way he did it really bothered me. He took a national intelligence estimate. We all know, you know what national intelligence estimate, and leaked it to Judy Miller and caused all sorts of hell. And of course he identified a CIA agent, but that wasn't as bad as the former, I don't think. Yeah.
Kevin, do you think that he's going to
have
to
say
Kevin Snowden?
Kevin?
Snowden.
Edward Snowden.
Edward Snowden, yeah. What's going to happen to Edward Snowden?
What do you think? I mean, his father has pleaded for him to come home. I don't really understand that.
Well, there was some, I don't really know the answer to that, but I'll give you a guess. But it was fun on today's, this was a phone press conference. You know, we all got on the phone and talked. So Assange, who obviously did all the talking, turns out has been advising Snowden and telling him what to do, and I would think probably advising him go to Iceland, because today's paper said that Iceland has received a request for Snowden to go to Iceland. So that would be the first part of the answer. Secondly, if not, he'll be extradited and he'll be convicted, and he should be convicted of something. The question is, again, how much and for how long.
James, I'm not going to get in a debate with you, who know that on many of those points I disagree.
I know.
However, one thing I would point out to you, you mentioned clear and present danger.
Yeah.
It's interesting, historical. That's a Oliver Wendell Holmes case, Schenck versus U.S., based on that Espionage Act. 1918, I believe the case was. Another one related to that was Debs v. U.S. And the reason that he talked about clear and present danger is because Wilson had been prosecuting these people for activities against the war, even verbal, and he put Debs in jail, his attorney general, for 10 years. All right. So the severity of it, which I thought was very severe, and you'd agree that was horrendous, a guy who ran for president, right, got 6.5% of the vote. Wilson's AG gives him 10 years. So my question, rather than go point by point, is this. What's the definition of a journalist today?
Oh, well, no one knows the answer to that. My own definition is someone who's regularly engaged in gathering the news for publication. Now, I mean, that's as good as anyone. And I think that would apply. I think that it would apply to Assange. The problem with using that definition as applied to Assange or thinking of Assange as a journalist, it's so different than anything we've ever known before that we say instinctively that's just too passive to fit the definition of being a journalist. But if in fact he's a publisher, how does he get the information unless there's someone as a journalist who gives it to him? So, I mean, you back into it, and I think you can argue it either way. From my point of view, I don't care if he's a journalist or not, because he's clearly a publisher. And if we're going to criminalize the publication process, we don't want to have Assange, who is a new electronic publisher, as an example, because if he can be gotten, so can others. In other words, what's the difference between Assange's website, where he publishes WikiLeaks material leaked to him by Manning, and the New York Times website that does exactly the same thing? The two are identical there, so I feel fairly confident that's a very good argument. When you get to the journalist part, it's a little bit more difficult, which I guess is your point.
I'd like to say that I saw the movie. I don't know if you all know, but there's a documentary out on Julian Assange, which is fascinating.
Oh, is it good?
Yeah. And have any of you seen it? But it really shows, it's a lot about his personality, but it also shows the historical part of what happened, the sequence, et cetera. It's fascinating.
Yeah, he was, I'm on the publisher side of this thing. I don't want to be on the leaker side particularly. I've known Ellsberg for a long time. He can do his thing. I want to do my thing. Assange doesn't strike me as the most attractive person on the earth, but he functionally is the same as other publishers. Now, with respect to Manning, and you've got to think Manning and Assange, because Manning, everyone knows the Manning trial is going on right now. I don't know, because the New York Times is burying it, and you have to spend a long time on it. But Manning is just leaked too much to justify himself as a whistleblower in total. But there are parts of what he's done have generic whistleblower flavor. For example, the first thing that he leaked was a video of a U.S. plane shooting up Reuters and killing some Reuters people. Now, that should have been leaked. But not all the stuff fits that category, in my humble opinion. So therefore, when it comes to Manning, my position is he should go away for 20 years, but the government ought to lay off. I don't know what the heck the government is. Government's got an eight-week trial going on, and the only way you can figure out what the government is doing, I may be too cynical about this, is that they're trying to build up a case against Assange. In other words, they want to get Assange for talking to Manning to induce Manning to leak. And if somehow Assange goes over the line of being, quotes, a reporter, and pushes too far, then they can say Assange is a conspirator. And that's what I'm so worried about. But why are they spending so much time on this case right now? Unless they're trying to build a whole factual pattern and they can turn around and get Assange later.
We're going to try and wrap up by 8, but maybe one more question.
Yes.
Could you distinguish our president because he is a constitutional lawyer as opposed to other presidents that have opposed this?
You know, that's an interesting question. You know, that's what people have said to me. Gee, how can it be? Obama is, or he's been my hero for some time. I would say over the last 3 or 4 weeks, much less. And he's a constitutional lawyer and taught constitutional law at University of Chicago Law School, from which I graduated. How do you explain all this? Well, I don't know, did anyone see the Charlie Rose interview of Obama? Well, I didn't see it, but I read it. But there's something arrogant about Obama when it comes to law, when he flatly says the NSA program is legal without any doubt. I mean, that's just not so. So I'm not sure whether being a constitutional lawyer helps him or hurts him, because it gives him so much self-confidence that he's right that he doesn't see where he's heading. And I would say a lesson in the Pentagon Papers is don't get mesmerized by national security, because it turns out badly. That's what happened to Nixon. His fall began with Pentagon Papers. Maybe Obama won't turn out badly, but right now he's not doing too well in this area, I would suggest.
Okay.